Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to welcome everyone to a meeting of the Military Personnel Subcommittee of the House Armed Services Committee. The hearing will come to order. As we proceed, we will be hearing testimony from the representatives of the Military Coalition and the National Military and Veterans Alliance about military personnel issues addressed in the President's budget submission for fiscal year 2015. Veteran service organizations are vital to providing firsthand advice and counsel to members of Congress, and we really appreciate you being here today. Maintaining an all-volunteer force that has experienced almost 13 years of persistent conflict is paramount for our national security. The subcommittee remains committed to ensuring that the men and women of our armed forces, military families, and the retirees who have served before them receive the benefits and entitlements they deserve. The President's budget significantly reduces ground and Air Force in strength and slows the growth of compensation and personnel benefit programs for all service members, shifting spending to other programs. Our focus today is to discuss with the beneficiary and advocacy organizations that represent military members, their families, and retirees, the reductions the department is proposing to create and efficiencies in personnel programs to include pay, compensation, and health care, and whether these proposals should wait until the Commission on Military Compensation is complete with its review and recommendations. Before I introduce our panel, let me offer Congresswoman Susan Davis, the ranking member of the Committee of California, an opportunity to make her opening remarks.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you both for being here. I also want to welcome our beneficiary representatives, Michael Hayden, who's representing the Military Coalition, and Rick Jones, who is representing the National Military and Veterans Alliance. Big responsibility, a lot of people behind you. Thank you both for being here to represent a collection of military and veterans organizations. We know that there were many organizations that would like to have testified before the committee, and so we have a number of their written testimonies that will be submitted for the record, and as you know, we could not accommodate everyone's desire. It has been several years since we had the beneficiary organizations before the subcommittee. I believe that the last beneficiary hearing also focused on proposed changes to the defense health system that was included in the President's budget. And here we are again, only this time the proposals being put forth are even more extensive than just military health care. And so the committee is faced with assessing the impact of several personnel and health care proposals that have been included in the President's budget. These include a 1% pay raise for the force, except for general and flag officers who would receive no pay raise in FY15, an increase in the out-of-pocket expenses for housing, a reduction in appropriated support for the commissary system, travel and transportation benefit changes, and a restructuring and fee increase for the TRICARE system. Individually, you know, maybe to some, that does not seem significant, and the all-volunteer force may be able to withstand these changes. However, we know that that's not the case, that these changes are all being proposed as a package, combined with significant drawdown in end strength for the Army and for the Marine Corps, the realignment of forces in the Air Force, and an improving economy, which does have an impact, we know. Which is a good thing, but it also has an impact. There is concern that the collective change may have an adverse impact on service members and their families, and that they will vote by leaving the armed forces. Our nation, as we know, is facing difficult economic times. With the threat of sequestration in FY16 and beyond, the department will be faced with making very difficult decisions. And if we do not make any changes to personnel costs, it will mean that there will be less resources for those who do remain in uniform to train and be prepared to win our nation's wars. That said, I also think that we need to take into account the work of the Military Compensation and Retirement Modernization Commission to ensure that we understand the cumulative effects of all of these changes and the potential impact to the recruitment and the retention of the all-volunteer force. We need to work together, and I know the chairman shares that, to find a way forward that will continue to ensure the benefits are there for those currently serving, especially those who are in harm's way, and to ensure that the benefits being provided are sustainable into the future. I look forward to a productive dialogue on your thoughts of how we can move forward. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Ms. Davis. Now I'd like to welcome our distinguished witnesses. Mr. Michael F. Hayden, Colonel, U.S. Air Force, retired, the Director of Government Relations of the Military Officers Association of America, MOA. Mr. Hayden, Colonel Hayden, is representing the Military Coalition. And Mr. Rick Jones, Legislative Director, National Association of Uniformed Services. Mr. Jones is representing the National Military and Veterans Alliance. I ask unanimous consent to enter a statement from the Association of the United States Army, the Air Force Association, the Retired Officers Association, the National Military Family Association, the Veterans of Foreign Wars, the Military Officers Association of America, and the U.S. Naval Sea Cadets into the record. Without objection, so ordered. Colonel Hayden, we'll begin with your testimony. As a reminder, statements are to be held to 5 minutes, and Craig Green's going to make sure all of us stay within the five-minute rule. He's above reproach on his ability to keep time. And then following your presentation, Mr. Jones, look forward to this, obviously. And we do have your written testimony. Following each of your testimony, we'll have rounds of 5 minutes each until adjournment. So we now proceed with Colonel Hayden.
Chairman Wilson, Ranking Member Davis, and distinguished members of the subcommittee, on behalf of our coalition partners, I thank you for providing the opportunity to testify today on the FY2015 budget proposals by the Department of Defense. At the heart of the budget challenges facing the department is the devastating effect of sequestration. Although the Bipartisan Budget Act of 2013 mitigated the sequestration spending cuts for FY2014 and 15, the original sequestration cuts for 16 and beyond remain in effect, and we believe will place national security at risk if continued. The coalition strongly urges Congress to eliminate sequestration and fund our military levels that enable our components of the armed forces to be adequately manned, trained, and equipped to focus on the mission. While debt reduction is a national priority, we believe such a disproportionate share of this burden must not be imposed on the Pentagon, and especially on the backs of the military members and their families. No federal obligation is more important than protecting national security. And the most important element of national security is sustainment of a dedicated, top-quality, career uniformed force. The past 12 years of unprecedented demands and sacrifices highlight how radically different military service conditions are from civilian life. The only times the all-volunteer force has been jeopardized has been to budget-driven cutbacks in the military compensation package that gave insufficient weight to the extraordinary demands and sacrifices inherent in a service career. Yet budget critics persist in asserting that military pay and benefits since 2000 are unsustainable, and they should be slashed to resemble civilian benefit packages. We believe it's important to put the growth since 2000 argument in the proper context to understand why military pay and benefits rose faster than the average Americans from 2000 to 2010. Has cost growth gone up since then? Yes, certainly. But using 2000 as a baseline, without reflecting on the historical context, is grossly misleading. This implies that the turn of the century was an appropriate benchmark for estimating what reasonable personnel and healthcare spending should be, and nothing could be further than the truth. At that time, years of budget cutbacks had depressed military pay to where a 13.5% pay gap existed. It cut retirement value by 25% for those post-1986 entrants. It had military families paying 18 to 20% out of pocket for their housing costs, and it booted beneficiaries over the age of 65 completely out of the military healthcare system. As a result, retention was on the ropes, and the Joint Chiefs of Staff at the time were imploring Congress to fix the problems to prevent a readiness crisis. And Congress worked diligently over the next decade to restore military pay comparability, to repeal the retirement cuts, to zero out the housing costs, and to restore promised health care for older retirees. And the coalition thanks you for that. In other words, the cost growth was essential to keep the previous cutbacks from breaking the career force. Since then, Congress has implemented changes that have slowed the growth to personnel. A 16% increase to TRICARE Prime enrollment rates and significant increases to pharmacy fees, and both will continue to increase in the future years at the rate of inflation. Mandatory mail order pilot for maintenance meds for TRICARE for Life beneficiaries was also implemented. End strength reductions to the tune of 124,000 service members have already been started by the services, and this budget calls for an extra 78,000 plus in end strength cuts. Since 2010, pay raises have dramatically slowed. They have either kept pace with the private sector pay, or in the case of this year, they've been capped below private sector. The fact is that since 2000, personnel and healthcare costs experienced an average of about a 7.6% rate of growth, but that cost growth was essential to keep the previous compensation cutbacks from breaking the career force. And since 2010, personnel cost growth has already slowed to less than 2% per year. Between the FY14 and 15 pay caps, this proposed BAH change, the planned reductions in the commissary and the new health care fees, and EFI's family of four would experience nearly a $5,000 loss in purchasing power annually. For an O3, that family of four would experience nearly a loss of $6,000 annually. These budget proposals would be major steps backwards towards repeating the insidious measures which led to retention and readiness problems in the past, and would undo the needed compensation improvements Congress put into place since 2000. These piecemeal reductions are doubly inappropriate since the congressionally directed commission could be offering even broader reforms next year. America will remain the world's greatest power only as long as it continues to fulfill its reciprocal agreement to the only weapon system that has never let our country down. And that's our extraordinary, dedicated, top-quality, all-volunteer force. Thank you, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you so much, Colonel, and we appreciate your insight that you presented. Mr. Jones.
Member Davis and members of the subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to appear before you this afternoon. National Military Veterans Alliance member organizations are deeply troubled by the administration's budget plan, constrained as it is by a cap limiting national security resources. The plan makes steep reductions in force structure, compensation, and benefits that we cannot support. Certainly, progress must be made against the deficit and national debt. However, defense spending is not the driver of our national deficit or debt. It's a declining percentage of our nation's total economy. It's less than 18% of the total federal spending. Yet under sequester, defense pays 50% of the cuts. It's disproportional. It's disproportional by any measure, citing cutting defense too deeply, too steeply, too quickly. We were told it would never come into effect. Yet we're now in year two of this blunt approach. Sequestration was bad policy when suggested. It was bad policy when accepted. It's bad policy when it began. And it remains bad policy to let it continue. To allow sequester level cuts to persist would be a huge strategic miscalculation. It is not in our country's best interest. The National Military and Veterans Alliance urges you to end sequestration on national security spending. Regarding the Pentagon proposals, the proposals include lower pay raise, increased out-of-pocket costs for housing, lower savings at the commissaries, increased TRICARE fees. The administration calls this a reasonable approach. In making the case for higher TRICARE fees, Comptroller Robert Hale said, fee hikes would bring money to the Pentagon, needed for readiness. Secretary Hagel said, we have to burn personnel costs to save readiness. Alliance organizations are all for military readiness. This is a perilous time. Failure to assure readiness presents an unacceptable risk to our nation and her troops. Readiness, however, is the responsibility of all Americans. Peace and national security are the most basic duty of the people as a whole. We can't just place the burden on the backs of our service members. We commend members of the subcommittee for rejecting previous plans to increase TRICARE fees. Pentagon leadership used to say TRICARE costs were crippling national security, eating us alive. In a letter to former Secretary Panetta, you recognized that instead of draining resources, the TRICARE account served as a cash cow. It was rated to pay for cost overruns in other programs. You noted that in 2012, $708 million was stripped out of the TRICARE account, $772 taken out in fiscal 2010, a whopping $1.36 billion taken in fiscal 2011, and in fiscal 2013, $800 million moved. TRICARE is the most important non-cash benefit provided those who serve a career in the military. It's a promised benefit, part of a moral contract for a force that has served us well. To uphold this moral contract with our men and women in uniform, their families, and military retirees, we urge rejection of the new Pentagon plan to set participation fees for TRICARE programs. On commissaries, you know that commissaries are a core benefit of the military family, an integral part of total compensation. Military families see 30% savings at shopping at commissaries. They save up to $4,400 a year. The Pentagon plan would crush that savings, hitting families right in the pocketbook. The strangulation plan the Pentagon has foisted out would mean higher prices at the commissaries, making commissary shopping less attractive, resulting in fewer customer visits, diminished sales. It would also cause a deep drop in sales at exchanges which pay for morale, welfare, and recreation programs, such as childcare, sports programs for the family. Let me take an opportunity to praise this panel and the full committee for its passage as part of the 2010 National Defense Authorization Act, the Military and Overseas Voter Empowerment Act. The MOVE Act has removed many of the obstacles for voting, particularly for members overseas. It's been effective, but like nothing else, unlike everything on Earth, it's not perfect. We're asking you to take a second look at this and to consider ending the waiver for states that miss the 45-day deadline to mail ballots to those who request the right to vote. We also ask you to take a look at the SPPDIC bill, concurrent receipt, and a number of other issues that are outlined in the written testimony. Thank you again very much for the opportunity to testify.
Thank again both of you for being here today. It really has been so helpful to all of us in a bipartisan manner for the information that you provided to correct some misstatements that have been made to this committee about eating the healthcare budget alive. The research that was provided was very helpful to us, and so that we could best represent our constituents. So thank you very much. And indeed, the point needs to be made. Defense spending is not driving the national debt. Indeed, the primary function of the national government should be national defense. And so thank you for what you're doing to protect American families. Defense sequestration, it needs to be addressed. And we'll be having budget votes in the next 24 hours. And I'm very pleased, and good people can disagree, but Congressman Paul Ryan does include addressing defense sequestration in one of the votes we have tomorrow. For both of you, the three options for TRICARE have allowed family members and retirees to choose the best option for their family. There is an effort promoting that just one TRICARE option would be provided to streamline the system. What do you think of these changes, and how would it impact retirees, and how will the copays impact retirees, Colonel?
Thank you very much. This consolidation effort, as we look at it, where you take the TRICARE Prime standard and extra program, and you consolidate it into one, which much more looks like the old CHAMPUS program from years back, is from our perspective, the service members, to include not just the retiree population, it's also going to impact the currently serving family members, that they're going to be paying more and they're going to get less of a program associated with it. For example, under the program, you take the what is the TRICARE Prime enrollment fee, they relabel it as a participation fee, they keep the same value and keep it tied to the cost of living adjustments for that retiree, and what you end up losing here is the access standards that were guaranteed under TRICARE Prime, so that you would be guaranteed to be able to get an appointment either in the MTF or in the network associated with it, and that was the whole purpose behind paying the enrollment fee in the first place. On top of it, for the retirees over age 65, a rehash of what was somewhat the proposal from last year, that under this, they still wanted to do an enrollment fee for the TRICARE for lifers over age 65. And this time it's capped, it's at 2% of the retirees' pay, and there's some caps associated with it for those that are 06s and below, as well as a higher cap for those in the out years for general officers and flag officers. The real issue is that we just think that this is, it just flies in the face of the entire TRICARE for Life program itself, paying an enrollment fee where they're already paying Medicare Part B along with it. And there is no guaranteed access or anything else associated with this thing. So it's just foisting more fees onto the beneficiary, and that wasn't part of the original bargain when TRICARE for Life was put together. And the ultimate issue is when you go back and take a look at the proposals, what does it do to the currently serving family? And in there, to encourage, if you would, those that go and use the emergency rooms or they use the urgent care, well, now, for those families that actually will have limited or no access to military treatment facilities are going to end up paying much more on if it's an issue that takes place, if you have a broken arm over the weekend, or if you have someone who falls and your child and hits their head, they're going to now pay a copay to go into that emergency room associated with it. And from us, this is just flies in the face of what we should be providing to those military members and their families while they're serving. A lot of things transpired back in the late 90s where we went from hospitals and we downsized to clinics, and the clinics then no longer provided emergency room care on the weekends or in the evenings. And so now many of the service members, even on living on installations, if there's some kind of pop-up requirement, some medical emergency that they have, they're gonna have to race off the installation and they're gonna second guess that, because they're going to think about, do I want to pay the copay to go to the emergency room? They're going to want to wait and say, maybe I can wait a day until the military treatment facility actually opens up. And I don't think we should actually be doing that to our military members and their families.
Thank you very much. And Mr. Jones.
I agree completely with the Colonel. It looks as though the Pentagon has decided that TRICARE for Life was a mistake. And so they decided to attach a participation fee to it. We don't see it that way. We see TRICARE as the provision from a grateful nation for full, affordable health care to those who have served. It's a respect, in essence, a respect of the value that has been received by the service that has been given. We stand in freedom today because of that service, and that TRICARE for Life is provided as part of the value that has been received by the nation. We're very pleased with TRICARE for Life as it currently stands. We like it, we think it works well in most instances, and we disagree with the Pentagon on that issue. Regarding the consolidation, it appears as though, we currently have Standard and we currently have Prime. Prime has a fee attached to it, and it looks as though the consolidation would squeeze Standard and Prime into one outfit, one function, and essentially you'd pay Prime and receive Standard. It doesn't, you get less but pay more. So we do not believe that that's the direction you should follow either. It's not a good path.
And thank both of you. And as I conclude, I want to thank Mr. Jones for raising the issue of commissaries. This is a worldwide system which is beneficial to military families. It also provides employment for dependents and spouses worldwide. It's unique. It just simply can't be recreated without really having a negative impact on military families. I now proceed to Ms. Davis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I know that this is tough for everybody, and I think that the Congress has certainly great responsibility here, having not been able to come to a resolution at a time that was critically important for the country. And so I think we need to acknowledge that and try and move forward. I know how much time you spend with many of the people that you work with, and I'm sort of looking for some reactions from folks, and whether you have a sense from them that I think what I understand from your comments, of course, is that the sustainability issue is not really of so much concern. We probably need to be concerned about it, but I think right now there's not as much concern about that. What is it that you're hearing in terms of how we might prioritize some of this? Is there a difference in terms of the issues that we're speaking about right now? And what is your sense? We know that there have been surveys, better surveys than we had in the past. Healthcare certainly is at the top of those in terms of benefits that people are experiencing. And it matters a great deal whether you're talking to someone in the active service today or retirees, of course, that matters. But what is it that you're pulling out of this that maybe isn't quite as obvious here?
It's an interesting point, because when you go back to many of the surveys that are provided to service members, their families, retirees, and you try to look at prioritizing benefits, you can come up with statistically valid information that shows, you know, pay is extremely important, the retirement benefit happens to be important, health care, of course, extremely important. You could find surveys that come out and say the commissary is a terrible benefit. And that's true if you're talking to someone who's maybe an E1 or an E2 that has no kids. So the real issue is you have to go beyond the surveys. And the interesting part is what we're getting the feedback from right now, from retirees, from the currently serving, and we actually have with MOA today over 25 currently serving family members or currently serving members that are storming the Hill in efforts to try to get the message across on what they feel about these things, the proposals that are coming forward. And not to look at it as a priority message, but it's almost like a break the faith message is what they're happening. This isn't, if you're going to look at these proposals, which we have characterized as almost jello on the wall, it's just that the department wanted to come over, they wanted to provide things, they think they can do these things without hurting retention, which in our past case, you know, when you start doing pay caps, which is not just 1 year, they're talking now 2 years with an additional 4 years in this, that we repeat the bad behaviors of the past, where it took Congress 10 years to fix the pay gap that existed in the late 90s. So to prioritize associated with this, it all typically depends on the group that you're talking to. But our immediate feedback that we've received is that these proposals need to be blocked. They need to be looked at holistically. Congress put together the commission that's looking at this right now, and we're somewhat optimistic that they are looking at it just that way. The feedback,
do you think
the
that,
openness.
If I could interrupt, do you think that, who knows what they're going to come up with, but the fact that they are looking at these issues and maybe looking at it more holistically, understanding that there are a package that have an package of changes that would have an impact on our families, would the same kind of recommendations make a difference coming from them? I mean, is that part of what we're dealing with here?
I think the difference is their charter. The interesting part associated with it, they're not looking at a budget cutting drill, which this definitely is. This is just ways to transfer money out of the MLPERS account out of the DHP account and put it on the backs of the beneficiaries so that they can free up additional funding for other priorities within the department. The best part that we're getting from the commission themselves is that they're trying to look at this and find out if there's a way to provide the benefit that doesn't, that could be done much more efficiently, much more cost effectively, and at the end, actually could end up improving retention and recruiting, which is the overall driver for strong readiness. Mm-hmm. And from our perspective, that's the way you should be looking at these instead of hoping that after 2 or 3 or 6 years of pay caps or eliminating, because what this really is going to do with the commissary benefit is you end up potentially just wiping the benefit completely out. And the whole purpose behind that is you have people that are going to go from a 30% savings to a 10% savings in the commissary. And at the end of the day, they're going to vote with their feet. They're going to say, I'm not going to go and drive on the post, you know, where it's going to take me 2 gallons of gas to get there and back to get a 10% savings that we hope. And ultimately, it's going to shutter commissaries. That's what our bigger concern is. And there's a definite need, and that's why we're hoping a much more holistic approach will be part of the solution here, looking at these. I'm not saying we're going to embrace everything that comes out of this commission. No, I think the important thing is to have the commission do their work, let this come forward, and then let it go through the due process and allow this committee to take a very hard look at this to make sure we're not going to damage the recruiting and retention in the future.
It's interesting that most people do think, Ranking Member Davis, that pay is the most important thing and health care is not the most important thing to active duty. It's more important to retirees. Interesting study I saw the other day, I wish I could recall from where exactly, but it listed the priorities for active duty as being health care because healthcare. So many today are married. It's an all-volunteer force. Health care was number one. Education was number two. Pay was number three. So I think healthcare is important all down the line, and it's important to those families as a measure of quality of life. So it does matter.
Thank you.
And thank you, Ms. Davis. And we now proceed to Congressman Dr. Joe Heck of Nevada.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Thank you both for being here today. You know, Colonel Hayden, I think you just succinctly gave the best analysis of the difference between the charter of the commission and the budget drill going on inside the building. And so thank you for putting that out there. You know, one of the things that the phrase that's always thrown around is we have to keep faith with the men and women of our military. And I recently heard someone say that in the current financial environment, that the phrase keeping faith may take on a different definition. Where in the past, keeping faith was always about paying benefits and the promises made, whereas moving forward, keeping faith may be more about making sure the individual is trained and equipped. Again, this idea of moving money from a mill purse pot to a readiness pot. Your opinion on that changing or definition?
It's an interesting, what I would consider more of kind of a bumper sticker approach. For several years now, we've had unsustainability, growth is going through the roof, spiraling out of control, and now we're going, well, we need to slow the growth in the personnel accounts so that we have enough funding to provide for readiness, to provide for the equipment and the training associated with it. We look at it as almost like a false choice. If you need to look at this as an entire package. You need to have the funding there for the acquisition programs, for the training, the equipment, definitely. But if you start scraping away at the pay and benefits, those things that you need in order to sustain the all-volunteer force, at the end of the day, you may not have the trigger pullers or the bomb droppers that you need. And that's where the real concern is for us. We're repeating some of those same behaviors. And unfortunately, one of the bigger things that we're leveraging in this debate right now is end strength. As to try to balance the budget, if you would, or look at where the early savings are, as a former force planner myself with the Air Force, I was there. I knew what you could do with N-Strength. Quick fix, quick money, and you draw down the force in order to go ahead and fund the F-35 or the F-22 program, which we did. And you cut below, and you're sitting there going, we can go down to 90% manning. And I feel that at the time was a wrong maneuver that we did in the Air Force, and I'm looking at it right now that we're just repeating that same bad behavior.
Mr. Jones, you know, we talk about, and you both mentioned some of the proposed changes in TRICARE. And I agree that what the drill looks like is really not, although it's being done under, quote, decreasing the cost of health care, end quote, that we're really not decreasing the cost. We're just shifting who's paying for it.
Sure.
Right? So we're not decreasing cost. But to that end, if, let's say, the commission or the entities come forward and say, look, we're looking at ways to try to actually decrease cost before coming to you and saying we need more premiums, fees, and copays, like the consolidation of TRICARE programs, irrespective of, let's say, it was done in a cost-neutral basis to the beneficiary, but there's opportunities for efficiencies, and yeah, you may not get the appointment as quickly as you wanted, but this is a way for us to try to actually decrease costs to stave off increasing premiums and copays. Mr. Jones, where do you think that would fall with the community?
Well, it's interesting. You see, we aren't really decreasing costs. If you push costs or shift costs to the beneficiary, part of this package is to actually reduce or slow the growth of TRICARE. The attendance, people won't go, may not go, be more hesitant to go to see a doctor. That's one of the elements of this. We noted a couple of years ago that was exactly what the department had in mind with rising TRICARE fees. They thought fewer people would go, fewer people would participate in TRICARE, more people would jump the system, go into the private sector, or perhaps go into the exchange, which is now out there. So there is an element of decreasing costs with this shift. I may have missed your okay. point, but...
Well, I guess, you know, if there's recommendations to come back that would fundamentally change the system, like, let's say, a consolidation of the TRICARE programs, in an effort to truly decrease costs to the system so that there was no increased cost to the beneficiary, is that something that the community would be willing to look at and be willing to support?
Yeah, we'd be more than willing to look at something like that.
Okay.
And I have to agree. I think the real issue here is... if it's transparent to the beneficiary, or if the beneficiary actually, and what the commission is telling us, they're trying to figure out a way to even provide the benefit, a better benefit, at even a potentially right. lower cost. And that should be real, the premise behind it. It shouldn't just be a cost-cutting drill. Yeah. It shouldn't be just, right. well, let's do away with TRICARE Prime because it's more expensive, and that's what I think the real issue is. We would be more than willing to take a hard look at these kind of proposals that provide the same level of benefit or better at a lower cost.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. My time has expired.
And thank you, Dr. Heck. We now proceed to Congresswoman Carol Shea Porter of New Hampshire.
Thank you very much, and thank you for being here. And let me say I started off very prejudiced, having been a military spouse, and my father-in-law ran the commissary. So, you know, I'm starting off in a position of actually knowing what this means to families. So I wanted to start by talking about the commissaries. My understanding is that a lot of the lower paid rank and file are actually qualifying for food stamps or a SNAP program. So what impact would this have if we take the commissaries away and they lose basically the savings that they have? Can you kind of estimate the impact that you think this would have on these families?
Well, your point is well taken, that there is an increase in food stamps in certain segments of the military and families particularly, of course. And it would hit them in the pocketbook. They would have to, the food stamps and their budget for food would not go as far. There are other payments for other concerns they may have for the family would have to be reassessed. So the point is well taken. Food stamps only go so far, and when you have an opportunity to save 30% or 30% of your food costs at the commissary, your money goes further at the commissary.
As a former economist from way back when, okay? I have kind of crunched some numbers associated with this. And I actually got some numbers from the department itself. DECA estimates that on the annual savings for a family of four, shopping exclusively at the commissary is around $4,500 a year. They don't have to pay because they don't use the Safeways or the Giants outside the gate. The interesting part is that with this proposal, because they go from what is a 30% savings on the average to now below around a 10% savings, it ultimately, for that family of four, they're going to lose $3,000 worth of purchasing power every year. That means they're going to have to find that $3,000 already within their budget to figure out how to pay and put the groceries, if you would, onto that table day in and day out. So that's where we see is the true financial loss associated with this.
Yeah, I find this breaking a social contract. You know, it's always been understood that if you served and you put your lives at risk and left your family or took your family places they might not have chosen on their own, that there would be, at the end of the rainbow, you know, there would be this. So I'm disturbed by pretty much all the changes there. But what is the tipping point? Because always in the military, if you ask active duty, they'll say, my dad served, my mother served, my grandfather served, my grandmother served. You know, there's a chain there. Mm-hmm. What's the tipping point, do you think, where they start saying, I can do better on the outside. This is just too much hassle. Or a family member says, that's it, I'm done. And I want to add to that, before you answer that, that I can remember during the Vietnam era, and my husband was at Fitzsimmons Army Medical Center, and there were a lot of unaccompanied men on their last tour of duty because their wives and families were just shot. They'd had it. And so they did their last assignment without their spouse there because they were getting ready to retire and they wanted to finally go home after 20 years or 25 years. So what's the tipping point, do you think, where people say, no, you know, looking at all of it, I just can't do it anymore. Love my country, but I can't do it anymore.
Hard to determine what the tipping point is, but in conversation with our members, we note that there is a loss of confidence and a hesitancy to recommend to the boy next door, to the family friend whose child is thinking about going military, a hesitancy to say, yes, this is a good way to go. Nevertheless, the military still represents an outstanding pathway to becoming all you can be. It offers a lot in education, in advancement, in confidence. So the military still stands as a great pathway in this country to have a better life.
I actually thought the tipping point was going to be about 2007. When you looked at what was taking place with the Army and the mid-level NCOs and the mid-level officers, if you would, actually junior mid-level officers, and they were starting to show some real strain. And the services had to, especially the Army, had to start providing retention bonuses at very high numbers associated with it in order to sustain that career force, if you would. What you needed, that real experience base in order to continue to lead. And when you look at that time frame, prosecuting two wars, multiple deployments, 15-month deployments at the time, all the other things that were going on to the force, I thought that's where we were really stretching it. And the only thing that I really believe that saved us a little bit, number one, were all the work that you were doing to bring that compensation package back to where it needed to be. And number two, we didn't have the greatest economy as we were coming out after that, shortly thereafter in 2008, which kept a lot of the folks in. And that has retained a lot of the folks. I'm more concerned right now that with the rhetoric that we're starting to see, that and with the forcing out that we're doing with the end strength reductions, we're hiding what could be a retention problem. We're already hearing from the service despers. They're talking about how recruiting is starting to tighten up because the economy is starting to come back. And our concern is that if you start doing this, where economy starts coming up, and at the very same time you start bringing down, if you would, the compensation package needed to sustain those people that have 10, 12, 15 years of service, there you're going to start putting real readiness at risk because you have to take 10 years, 12 years, 15 years to build those NCO and that officer corps.
That's my concern, too. Thank you. I yield back.
And thank you, Ms. Shea Porter. We now proceed to Congressman Dr. Brad Winstrup of Ohio. What? I can't believe he laughed. Okay. we have Congressman Austin Scott from the Republic of Georgia.
It's Wednesday. It was time for you to have a minor error, Chairman. Gentlemen, thank you for being here today. And I represent a tremendous number of men and women that serve our country, both in the civilian role and in uniform. And when I talk with the men and women back home, it just kind of makes the problem worse in how much of the cut they're being asked to take. And when they look at us and they see us pushing changes to their benefit programs, reducing the promises that have been made to them, most of them tell me, I understand that minor changes have to be made. I'm willing to take my share of them. Virtually every man and woman in uniform that works at our base says, I'll take my share. But when you're funding free cell phones, at the same time that you're cutting my benefits, that shows a lack of priorities from Congress. And I just like to say, you know, I'm sorry that we haven't been able to set our priorities any better than that as a Congress. And to the men and women that are out there, I hear you loud and clear. Dr. Heck mentioned something, and I agree with him, going back to the cost of health care. The cost of health care in this country far exceeds what a similar procedure costs in any other country in the world. And you can get a procedure may cost $1,000 at one facility and $3,000 at another one, and there's no correlation in price and quality of that procedure. And it seems to me that if there were a way for us to work with people like you to make sure that we were able to get the highest quality health care at the lowest possible price, then we could put that, we can do a better job of fulfilling that promise to the men and women in uniform. And so my question is, as we go through all of these budget reductions and things that are being forced on the Pentagon, are there alternative savings or reforms that you see are ways that we could do this where we get the men and women that deserve this benefit more for their dollar?
I'm more than willing to try to take this. I actually think there are ways to improve the benefit. When you look at healthcare delivery, right now we have somewhat service stovepipe still operations. DHA was a step to try to consolidate some of this, but we still have each of the surgeon generals that are associated with it, and they still have their own budgeting authority associated with the programs. Just when you look at economy of scale in purchasing, when you need, a piece of equipment in one hospital and you still need another piece of equipment in a military treatment facility, why not look at the economy of scale when you start doing the purchasing? Just because you're in one branch of a service and then another branch of a service and you have your own budget pots, maybe there can be a better way to do that, more of a purple way, if you would, to look. The coalition, not all coalition members have taken on and agreed to a unified medical command, if you would, but this economy of scale, at least on the budgeting aspects, we can see that you could get some economy of scale on that. And that's just one step. There's been several reports that have been out there before that have pushed to do just that.
And this is just somewhat brainstorming, but
you bet.
You know, the way we handle Medicare Advantage, the participant can choose between different insurance carriers. And my understanding is that with TRICARE, there's just one insurance carrier in the region that handles that, and there is no choice for the consumer. I wonder if we maybe took some of the the things that we do in Medicare Advantage, where we've given the consumer more options. I wonder if we looked at trying that with TRICARE, if that would give us the ability to maybe drive down some of those costs. With that said, Mr. Chairman, I'll yield the 13 seconds that I have left.
Here, here. Thank you, Congressman Scott. Thank you for your passion and concern. We're going to proceed if there are any further questions. I just have one, because I just think a point that both of you have made just needs to be restated, and in particular, that is the impact on families and the actual fiscal, F-I-S-C-A-L, impact on a family, because that's what the people at home need to know and understand the consequence, because they can identify. Colonel, you've already indicated a $5,000 net reduction in spendable capital. Both of you, if you could restate again, do you see the additional cut of out-of-pocket housing expense combined with the reduced less than ECI pay raise and an increase in commissary prices as a cut in the purchasing power, and again, an estimate from each of you on enlisted and officers? Colonel first, and then Mr. Jones.
It is definitely a loss of purchasing power at the end of the day. The annual loss that we found for an E5, 10 years of service, if you would, family of four, with these proposals fully in place. And I consider this still a very conservative estimate. I used DOD's numbers for the health care, if you would, which was what they figured was be an additional about $200 out of pocket that a family would see. And I only did 2 years of the pay caps instead of the full 6 years of pay caps. So with that in place, at the end of the 2 to 3 years of implementation associated with this, they're looking at a loss of annual purchasing power of $5,000 for that E5. And for that O3 family of four, it's almost $6,000.
Sadly, that's a number that families can understand.
It is a number that families can understand, and we agree with the numbers. But there's also a retention here. There's a cost to the country as well. These folks who lose that amount of money may decide that this is not the path they want to follow. They don't want to follow a career in the military. They don't want to serve in the military. And that is a consequence of these proposals. A possible consequence, second tier, third tier, or fourth tier consequence that we haven't really looked at with this budget plan that's come out from the Pentagon.
And Ms. Jones, thank you for pointing out about retention. And people need to understand the persons who are serving in our military are very skilled. We are facing an asymmetric illegal enemy combatant, not in uniform, people who use women and children as shields. We've really never seen such conflict, and the training of our military personnel is extraordinary to face people who would eagerly and enthusiastically, with a vehicle-borne IED, blow up a group of children. How can you? The training for this takes time. So I want to thank you. And anyone else? Any further question? Yes, Ms. Davis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I know in your positions you might not necessarily have some of the input from the Guard and Reserve, but I'm wondering, in certainly in terms of the commissary, and I think some of the latest studies demonstrate that it's actually the Guard and Reserve that are using food stamps at a fairly high rate. Do you have any sense of that and the usage in terms of the commissaries for the Guard and Reserve and how they would be impacted by this? I guess the food stamp really would indicate that in their regular jobs, in addition to the time that they deploy as Guard and Reserve, that they're struggling, and we know that we've had a number of attempts to cut food stamps, which does affect this group of folks.
The economy has not been good, and we've watched an explosion in food stamp usage. Whether it's due to the economy or due to expansion of eligibility in food stamps, no one's really sure at the present, but we just recognize that, I guess it's 41 million people today are on food stamps, 7 million, some 6-7 years ago. I'm not sure of those, but I recall reading an article on that. But I do not have statistics on the reserve use of food stamps, just the knowledge that food stamps are being used in the commissaries. And I spoke with someone just the other day who said to me, it breaks my heart to see a young family at the commissary using mm-hmm. food stamps.
Yeah. I know heart. In our community as well. I mean, many groups have stepped in, actually, to provide help from the, you know, vegetables and sure. meals and a whole host of others for our service members at Benwellton and other places.
And we don't have the statistical information associated with that. It is something that I could take back and try to provide you some information that we have. The one thing I do know about food stamps, and it's kind of an interesting twist, at least for the currently serving, the active duty force, mm-hmm. if you would, when you take a look, there is some rule sets associated with it that if you're living on post, of course, you're not receiving a housing allowance associated with it. And so you could actually qualify for food stamps living on post, where if you live off post and are receiving a housing allowance, it then goes in and it shows the scale associated with it. So you wouldn't be eligible to receive the food stamps. So it becomes one of those things, what counts, what doesn't count, as you try to figure out the eligibility criteria on this. But mm-hmm. I will go back and take a look at the Garden Reserve
yeah.
and get back
okay.
to you.
Okay, thank you. And I know that we also have obviously had a chance to speak to service chiefs on this issue, and probably in the next few weeks, I think that, you know, they feel there's a case to be made in terms of readiness and whether or not families would trade off that. Again, it's false choice, I think, as you're, but nevertheless, would they trade off training and access to supplies, not to cannonize ships, all those things, for other changes that would be occurring? I'm sure you've had those discussions.
Well, it's just when you put a cap on how much you're going to allow for spending in defense, make it a arithmetic exercise rather than basing the expense on your national strategic plan or the threats that you face, I think you're always going to have a problem squeezing out some of these very important programs that help the quality of life for families and those who serve. And that's what we're in this year, and there mm-hmm. are trade-offs in that, and we just shouldn't be there. Mm-hmm. We should not be there with our defense policy. This was the wrong way to go, and again, we were told we'd never follow this path of sequestration.
Can I ask you, did you think that the commission, did they ask the right questions? Do you think they were helpful in that way, trying to, as they interviewed you?
The military compensation retirement?
Right.
Their questions, they're looking, I think, at the right things at the present time. They may have been the source for the earlier comment about the survey, putting health care, education, and pay in that order with our young service members.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. And we now proceed to Congressman Scott.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll make this brief. Colonel Hayden, I think one thing that I think as we do the arithmetic, as you said, Mr. Jones, and making sure that the public understands the impact of this is we're not talking about $4,800 a year from somebody who makes $200,000 a year.
Correct.
And so you said this is for an E-5?
The E-5 loses about 8% of their regular military compensation with this. The RMC, if you would, what is many times measured by the department itself, about a 6% loss is what we calculated, and that's kind of a back of the envelope, so trust me on this, that's what we're looking at, but about an 8% or a 6% reduction in RMC.
But as a percentage of their disposable income, it would be significantly higher. Just like every American, they have car payments, they have other payments that come out of their paycheck that are not optional, that they can't just get rid of.
This is money they have to find in their current budget now.
That's absolutely right. And so while it may be 8 or 10% of pay, it may be 40 or 50% of disposable income that they have after they've made their car payment and other payments that they have. So just I appreciate what you're doing. Look forward to working with the two of you and helping you.
Thank you, Mr. Scott. Dr. Heck.
Thanks, Mr. Chair. I just want to follow up on a couple things. Certainly, I appreciate the perspective you give about the impact on retention, but, you know, it's also going to impact accessions, mm-hmm. right? And as we've seen recent surveys showing that there's a much lower propensity towards military service of men and women, or males and females in high school right now for entering military service. Of course, part of that is due to a resurgent economy, but also many people are concerned about what that phrase, keeping faith, is going to mean to them should they commit to time and service. And Mr. Jones, I think you said it very well in that this is turning into an arithmetic problem as opposed to a strategy problem. And I think, although not in this subcommittee, but that's been a discussion that we've had about the last QDR,
yeah.
And really trying to develop a QDR to a budget as opposed to the legislative mandate, which is the 20-year outlook at low to moderate risk. I agree that we need to withhold any decisions until we hear from the commission. In fact, that was the point I brought up when we had the assistant secretary and the G1s here not too long ago. So I appreciate you reiterating those points. Thank you both for being here and representing the men and women in uniform in our retiree population. We appreciate it. Yield back.
Thank you, Dr. Heck. And again, thank both of you for being here, Colonel Hayden with the Military Coalition, and Mr. Rick Jones, who's representing the National Military and Veterans Alliance. And I'd like to remember that Mr. Jones actually served at Moncrief Military Hospital, Army Hospital at Fort Jackson, South Carolina, and he's still beloved. So this is good. And thank you all, your sincerity on behalf of the military families and retirees. Thank you, and we are adjourned.